Hello and welcome to this week's webinar of the series, How to Continue Solid Waste Management Services During the COVID-19 Pandemic. Thank you again for joining. And today we will talk about adapting the systems. My name is Nila Kapp. I'm working at waste management on waste management at UN Habitat. And this webinar is brought to you jointly by UN Habitat and the Wuppertal Institute under the Urban Pathways Project. Before we start, just some technical guidance. There is a questions box in your control panel. Use this to post questions. Please say who this question is for. Just state quickly who you want to ask. And if you just want to say hi, if you want to do a comment or let us know anything, please use the chat box for that one, okay? There's also a special chat box. And just to let you know, this webinar is recorded and we will provide the recording after the webinar on the website where you're also registered. Great. And before we start, I want to introduce a colleague from the Wuppertal Institute. Her name is Lisa, and she will help me give you a short introduction. But let me just share my screen for you. And oh, you already see. And to guide you through the agenda. After we hear something from Lisa, we will talk about municipal waste management and COVID-19 from Paula Marengo, who is of the Association for Regions and Cities for Sustainable Resource Use. Then Donovan Story from the Global Green Growth Institute will talk about the rise of new and old waste. And afterwards, I'm not sure if you can, I hope you like at the moment this is, let me just pause for a second my screen sharing and share it again with you because, okay, now you should be, I'll share it again with you. Okay, there's some, again, some problems. I'm very sorry for that.
We can see it.
Okay, perfect. I cannot see it. Okay, so I hope this is the slide that you're seeing. I wanted to tell you that Nicola Herrmann is communicating measures. And hopefully Zhang Cheng from Wuhan in China will talk about you adapting the system. So I will give it over to Lisa. Lisa, please come and join me. Which slide can you see now, Lisa? Just let me know.
Well, I see the first one still from the agenda, the introduction and first presentation. So maybe if you go to the third slide. Yeah, but also, I mean, I can just start
and I'll try to... There we go.
Okay, thank you also from my side on behalf of the Wuppertal Institute to join today's webinar. And for those of you who were not able to join the first one of the series last week, let me just briefly summarize the main takeaways. So you also find the video and the slides and a written summary on the website newacampus.org, where you're registered for today's webinar. So the first speaker, Kate Medlicott, is team leader of sanitation and wastewater sanitation machine and health unit of WHO, and she listed in her presentation five main things on what you can do, which I would now like to share or remind you of. So for one, it's install hand hygiene facilities and make use obligatory. She really stressed that this is the most important prevention measure. Then to advocate for inclusion of water and solid waste management in country COVID-19 plans, so in healthcare facilities, in schools, in public settings, and make rapid wash and healthcare waste management improvements in healthcare facilities, especially where COVID-19 patients are or will be treated. And then fourth, to strengthen support to wash and solid waste management workers and hygiene promoters, so provide them with protective gear training, hand hygiene at work and home, and also give them free movement and protection. And last, ensure service providers that they have backup supplies and contingency plans for disinfection chemicals, fecal indicators, and chlorine testing equipment. Because effective inactivation of the virus on surfaces can be achieved within 1 minute using coming disinfectants. And then the second speaker was Antonis Maropoulos, president of the International Solid Waste Association, ISWA, and he shared some general considerations on the effects of COVID-19 on municipal solid waste management. So for one, it highlights the importance of science and data-driven decision-making, as well as the importance of global cooperation and coordination. And while this in some aspects can have a unifying element, he also pointed out that the current crisis also fragments our world in rich and poor and good and bad waste management services. Anton has furthermore stressed the fact that pandemics are urban and that COVID-19 might help recognizing municipal solid waste management as an essential service, and that governments should put proper measures in place to facilitate safe service delivery. He highlighted four key priorities during pandemics for municipal solid waste management. So first, to continue service without creating extra risk for public health by improper waste management, to take additional precautions for formal and informal waste management workers, to adjust recycling activities to avoid cross-contamination and infections, and to provide for safe treatment and disposal of the increased quantities of healthcare and medical waste. And Anton is finalized by highlighting the importance of municipal solid waste in our daily lives, which becomes more obvious than ever in these special times. And I think with his four priorities, he also pointed to the important issues that we hope we cover with this series. And with this, I would give back to Nick.
Great. Thank you, Lisa, for sharing these insights from last week. Before we start, as you already know from last week's webinar, we always want to know something from you. So we will start again our first poll. We will have overall four of them during the whole webinar. And the first one is already running. We just want to know where you're from, like where you're working, so we know who's listening in. You can tell us if you're from a government or from NGO, private sector, academia, or anything other. So I will give you some more time to find the right button to press. And then I would say we will close the poll. And as you can see, it's quite a mixture. A third from NGOs and a third from others. So thank you for sharing that with us. We will keep continuing asking you some things during the webinar. So now let us go to our first speaker. His name is Paolo Marengo, and he's a program manager and senior expert at ACR Plus, specializing in waste management and circular economy. He is currently involved in several projects concerning industrial symbiosis and circular solutions in the construction value chain, implementation of the life cycle approach in regional policies, pay-as-you-throw and no-as-you-throw schemes in the municipal waste management, mitigation and adaptation to climate change plans. He also drafts technical reports to support ACR Plus members. Paolo holds a bachelor's and master's degree in environmental engineering from the Polytechnic University of Turin. Paolo, we are looking forward to your presentation.
Yes, so good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Thank you, Nina, for your introduction, and it's a pleasure to be here. And thank you for organizing such interesting series of webinars. So I'm gonna launch my presentation. Yeah? Perfect. Is it fine?
Yes, now it's fine. I just wanted to let you know about the presentation.
Okay, thank you very much.
Sure.
Thank you. Okay, so I'm gonna talk about municipal waste management and COVID-19. And here is the agenda of my presentation. So I'm going to talk about a collection of practices, decision-making processes, recycling and composting routes, and some of the main challenges ahead this crisis when it comes to municipal waste management in this period. So, does this picture look familiar to you? This is, let's say, a primitive trash collection system when waste collection started as a way to protect the health of citizens. So the COVID-19 outbreak has put, again, health in the focus of waste management. And even if the coronavirus pandemic has a global dimension, it has also a strong local dimension, even stronger when it comes to waste management. And indeed, in most of the European countries, municipal waste management is under the responsibility of local authorities, especially when it comes to the collection. So it makes, much of a difference the way decentralized authorities have adapted to the emergency. So let me just spend a few words about ACR Plus. ACR Plus, as Nila already mentioned, is the Association of Cities and Regions for Sustainable Resource Management. And we are a technical network. So we publish studies, take part in projects, facilitate the exchange of experiences among our members. And of course, our members have been greatly impacted by the COVID-19. And some of them asked us for support to get information about waste management in the current situation. So basically, we started exchanging with the members, contacting project partners, sharing information with our contacts from other organizations. And this is how our initiative started. The result is the web page that you can find on our website. And here at the top of the slide, you have the link. So in terms of municipal waste collection services, it's very complicated to have an accurate snapshot of the current situation, because there are very diverse and dynamic ongoing processes. We tried to summarize the main trends observed in this infographic. But it's important to point out that the purpose of this scheme is not to provide guidelines, rather than to schematize the main trends observed. And as you can see, we broke down municipal waste management in blocks, and for each of them, we pointed out the main trends. So in terms of general adaptations, what we have observed is a significant impact on the civic amenity sites and resource centers. Also specific on-demand services such as bulky and garden waste collection have been interrupted to prioritize other services such as residual and bio-waste collection. Street cleaning operations have been also in the focus. And in several cases, we have noticed the release of specific instructions and procedure for such a service. So concerning household waste management, the main trends observed rely on addressing specific instructions to the households with confirmed or suspected to be infected people. And the instructions are about to stop taking out source separate waste, asking those households to get rid only of the mixed waste in two or more, even more closed bags. Some countries have ruled a minimum home storage time before put the waste out for collection. And this time actually varies across the countries. For instance, from one day, this is the case of France, to few days, that is the case, for instance, of UK, Estonia, and other countries. In some local authorities, specific services to households with COVID-19 cases have been set up in order to keep separated the waste streams. And this is the case, for instance, in some regions from Italy, for instance, Tuscany region and Sicily. But of course, this choice implies many challenges in terms of logistics and data management. For the other citizens, the trends are about trying to keep on operating the source separation. Of course, there are modifications in terms of collection frequency and in some cases in the collection schemes. In case of temporary interruption of separate collection, citizens are normally asked to cooperate, trying to keep as much as possible at home dry recyclable fractions, such as glass, paper, cardboard. Of course, local conditions play much of a role. Let's say rural areas are more resilient in adapting, due, for instance, to normally more space to store waste at home. When it comes to waste treatment, automated operations are normally encouraged to minimize the manual operations. But of course, this is not always possible. And logistics operations, such as transfer and storage of waste, are also impacted. Some regions have set derogations to permitted capacity storages in order to guarantee a bit more flexibility in the logistics and in the supply chains. However, this might generate risks in terms of sanitary conditions, fire risks, and et cetera. So when it comes to decision-making processes, we observed a wide range of adaptation, resorting into either top-down or bottom-up approaches. In some countries, the preparation of contingency plans started with guidelines issued at the national level by healthcare institutions. Then they were transposed and adapted to local implementation plans. Let's say the three gears of national authorities, decentralized authorities, and local communities have to roll out in the same direction to guarantee that the actual implementation follows the strategy. The information we have received from the field shows variable shortages and bottlenecks along the recycling and composting routes. And this is posing issues regarding environmental objectives, but also in terms of cost coverage for local authorities. So here you can see some examples of local actions to increase the resilience of the systems. These examples come from some of our members, and they are about communication actions to the citizens to face the emergency, putting waste prevention in the focus. So as I mentioned before, it's very challenging to have accurate figures and come up with consistent pictures of what is going on at the local level. Since all the processes are always changing, some collection services might be interrupted and then reactivated, depending on national decisions, for instance. And in this slide, we framed some of the challenges, such as citizen behavior changing, the need of reallocate staff, redesign collection routes, implement health and safety measures, such as, for instance, modifications of the shift. So coming to some feedback from the field. In this slide, we displayed some data from surveys delivered by AMORS in France and ADEPT in England. They are both association of local authorities, and both surveys aim at analyzing the modifications of the collection services during lockdown. Overall, mixed waste collection is maintained, while there are some disruptions in the separate collection services. The biggest impacts are on bulky waste, garden waste, and civic amenity sites. And unfortunately, there's also some increase of fly tipping. When it comes to waste generation, here there are some data about waste generated in Catalonia and the city of Milan. In the Catalonia region, the mixed waste registered a drop of about 12%, while the source separated waste quantities registered a drop of about 20%. In Milan, total waste generation registered almost a 30% drop, with variable figures concerning the other waste fractions. And it is worth noticing that the residual waste registered a larger drop than the other household waste fractions. So meaning that sewer separation keeps on working quite well, even if, of course, it's challenging to compare this situation with, let's say, the business as usual one. Those data reflect impacts in terms of touristic activities, businesses, commuting, etc. So finally, we will have a lot of lessons to learn from this experience. And since we work closely with local authorities, we are going to launch a study to analyze how well the local collection systems have worked in order to improve their resilience and come up with the key factors to feed contingency plans, but also to move forward to more sustainable models. Here there are some links to web pages where hopefully you can find several information about what is going on at international level. And yeah, that's it from my side. I would like to thank you very much for your attention. I look forward to your questions. And if you are interested to contribute to our collection practices, we will very much appreciate your contribution. So thanks a lot.
Great. Thank you, Paolo. And our first question to you right now would be, you showed us the trends that were observed. Maybe you could just quickly tell us where you're, like, you selected those from member cities, right? So where are your member cities located mostly?
Basically, our members come from most of the member states in Europe. So the main trends reflect what is going on in terms of, let's say, in Europe. So yeah, I would say that we are also collecting some practices in some other countries outside Europe, but our figures reflecting more what is going on in Europe. Yeah.
Great, thank you. And also maybe to get on that one, what do you think? What are the some key trends that you also think will probably be happening or should be happening in countries where the waste management system is not like the European system, maybe not as developed or just a little bit different?
Yeah, I think that first of all, the main concern is for the workers working on the front line. So let's say where in the countries where the system are less automatized or let's say maybe more informal informal way delivered, it's very, very important to come to the workers with clear and accurate information about the risks and the safety and health measures that they have to hold to minimize the risk. And also I think that a key point is the communication to citizens. So I think that, for instance, as I showed, communication actions focused on prevention can be applied everywhere. And trying to adapt the behavior of citizens in such a period, it's very important to increase the resilience. And so whatever is the system, the contribution of citizens is crucial. And as I said, accurate information to the workers to make them aware of what are the risks and what are the measures that they have to follow to minimize health and safety issues. It's very important.
Yeah, right. Thank you for sharing. I'm glad we are talking next week more about worker safety. And I think also today we will hear a little bit more maybe of a communication. So before we go to our next panelist, we will share the next poll with you. And it's already on your screens. Please let us know how the waste collection in your city has been adapted. And we just heard there were some trends. And what did you realize what happened in your city? Was there a change of collection frequency? Was there, were you asked to stop segregating waste? You can also choose multiple options. So if everything was true, please put a vote on everything. If you were asked to store something at your home or somewhere else, was there an interruption or reduced on-demand service of on-demand services or a separate bin or bag for something like COVID-19 waste? So I'll give you all a little bit more time to answer these questions. So we can see what's happened out there. I see it's still early in the morning for some people. Everyone is a little bit hesitant to answer. So this is the time to wake up now, if it's morning for you. Maybe it's already evening, wherever you are. Okay. Great. Then we will close the poll and share the results with you. So there was mostly what we can see is that there was a change of collection frequency and also no more sort separation. Great, thank you for sharing this with us. This is also, of course, interesting for everyone to know. So we will now go to our next speaker, Dr. Donovan Story. He is currently the Deputy Director and Urban Lead of Green Cities at the Global Green Growth Institute in Seoul. In this role, he leads a team at the headquarters and works with 33 country teams and key stakeholders to identify and implement policies and projects in support of green transformation, including waste management and circular economy. In cities across Africa, Asia, and Latin America. Prior to joining the Global Green Growth Institute, Donovan worked for the United Nations and taught urban planning and environment management and development management at several universities. He has a PhD in international development and is a member of ISWA and ISUCARP. Donovan, we're looking forward to your presentation. And we see it perfectly.
Oh, that's great. Thank you. And you can hear me okay?
Yes, we can.
That's great. Hello, everyone, and thank you very much for the opportunity to participate in these important events. I think it's fantastic to do this while the pandemic is really still unfolding in a lot of countries, because it gives us the opportunity to reflect as things occur, and also go back to these reflections in time and see what we got wrong and what we got right. But it's very important, obviously, at the moment to be able to respond to the current crisis as it emerges, rather than to wait to some point in time. So I really congratulate all of the organisers for organising these at this time. And of course, people taking the time out to participate through their attendance and their questions and so on. So my presentation is really, as the title suggests, really looks at new and old waste. I have a short amount of time, so I just really wanted to focus on some key messages. First of all, something about the Global Green Growth Institute. I'm based in the headquarters here in Seoul in Republic of Korea, and it's a treaty-based organization, it's almost 10 years old now. And it really supports countries in transitioning to a green growth model of development towards a green economy, and a circular economy is very important to our work, particularly our urban work. And we work essentially, and we now have 36 member countries, and we work in sustainable landscapes, energy, and we work also in cities and in water. Some of our approaches to waste, if, for those that are interested, just through this link, this is a recent blog developed, which really highlights GGGI's approach to waste in its countries. And we predominantly work in developing countries and middle-income countries, emerging economies. So I'd speak from that perspective, really, which is a nice complement to the previous presentation, I hope. So this is a few key things, really, in terms of looking at things which are relatively obvious and big challenges for us that are engaged in waste and have a passion for waste to resource and circular economy approaches. And that is that we're very quickly learning that pandemics lack shared protocols. And we can see a range of responses from cities, from at the state level or the regional level, and then at the national level, to how to deal with waste streams and changing waste streams. Even within countries, we have significantly different approaches from various cities, and even within cities, different approaches within neighborhoods. And I think one of the important outcomes, I guess, and discussions which need to take place beyond the current pandemic situation is really to go back and look at the lessons learned in terms of management of waste, where cities and countries got it right, and where unnecessary disruptions occurred to the waste management system. But having said that, of course, we live in an environment in which everyone is relatively fearful of waste and all waste streams, and we know that once contaminated waste is mixed with all other forms of waste, then the whole waste stream is seen as contaminated, as toxic. And so, as the quote says from someone interviewed in the United States, in terms of the gloves and things and also in the United Kingdom that have just been thrown on the ground, as people don't want to take such things home and mix it in their household waste, is that, you know, you're not throwing out candy wrappers here. These are potentially toxic and contaminated materials which are finding their way into river systems and into public areas, as well as directly into landfills, of course. So what we've seen really is a rise of the fear of fully contaminated waste streams, and that's going to be a very difficult legacy, and currently it's a very difficult situation to handle, is to be able to unpick that concern over what's contaminated and what's not contaminated in waste streams. And it's really affecting the different kinds of behavior that we see in cities and in waste systems globally. Along with that, we're really seeing a major rupture to the waste messages that all of us have been really pushing for a number of years in terms of waste to resource, circular economy, recycling, source separation, and so on. All of these are really under challenge in terms of the conditions which everybody now faces, and including formal and informal sectors, households, and also, of course, authorities and those businesses engaged in waste. And so we're seeing a significant rupture to these waste systems and messages, which I think is going to be a legacy that we're going to need to rebuild back from. And of course, we see, as Paolo pointed out, a decrease in waste volumes. But what we're seeing is quite a shift in the materials making up the waste stream. And I'll talk about that again in a couple of minutes. But we're seeing obviously more gloves, more masks, and plastic goods and tissues. And we don't really have any known protocols around how to handle these materials, which leads to the sense that all the whole waste cycle is becoming contaminated by a lack of separation. And of course, the science is still out, and we receive different messages all the time about how long the virus can live on certain materials, whether it be cardboard or plastics or so on. And until we really have definitive answers for that in time, people's sense is that, you know, the virus can live on all materials for anything from between a few hours to several days up to a week. And so that means that there's a number of known unknowns, as I've referred it to there, for waste systems. Of course, we're starting to see some guidance notes and some information shared, the WHO interim guidance for waste management systems. And of course, ISWA, and I'm a proud member of ISWA, has got a very dynamic page in terms of advising us on materials as they become known from the country level and also from WHO itself as well, and sharing what different countries and cities are doing. In terms of new forms, we're seeing something which I think we're really going to have to pay to a lot of attention to in the waste community, and that is the sort of resurgence of plastics, my sort of rise of the old forms of waste which we've been dealing with. And 2020 was going to become a fairly major year for a number of cities and countries in terms of banning single-use plastics and bags and other forms of plastics as well. And what we're seeing is a rollback of those bans, hopefully temporary, but you know, the plastics industry has really, I think, been on the front foot in terms of saying, well, you know, it shows how important plastics are to our society, really. And in this case, there's been a huge increase in demand on the basis of this whole concept of disposability and hygiene. And I think that we're really going to have to address a lot of these issues that plastics are, you know, they're great because they're disposable, and they're great because they keep everything clean, whether it be in clear film for hospitals or whether it be plastic bags for food deliveries, packaging and so on. So I think that this whole rise of resurgence of plastic is going to be a difficult but important challenge for us to be able to find alternatives to. And of course, that is now underpinned by essentially free oil. Of course, oil being a key driver of plastic prices, and that's going to make plastics extremely cheap in relation to alternative materials, and the cost difference is also a major driver for a lot of behavioural change from even those that are quite committed to more or organic-based materials and alternatives to plastic to go back to plastic. So we're really going to have to think about the impacts on our waste stream from this re-rise, this resurgence of plastic. Thailand's a great example of that, of a country that are committed to moving away from single-use plastic bags in particular. And plastic companies in Thailand have been facing losses for a number of years as materials have been increasingly shunned by bigger stores and then local markets. But we've seen a real pickup in terms of the use for deliveries and so on. Of course, that provides an alternative, an opportunity for us really to put biodegradable bags and other materials back into the equation. But it's going to need a fairly concerted effort to do so, I think, for a number of years. And circular economy, something again we've been working very hard to establish, are really also facing major disruptions. And we've seen a considerable shift back to single-use materials and even reusable materials. So a lot of supermarkets and countries are now refusing the entry of people to take in recyclable bags, even cloth bags, because they say there might be living virus on these materials, and they can't come back in until different levels of protocol change. So people have been encouraged to leave their recycled bags and their handbags at home, and to use again single-use plastic from shops. So again, this is sending out a whole bunch of messages which we've been trying to challenge for a number of years, which we will need to address as a community. And also, of course, the breakdown of source separation, which was mentioned earlier and also in last week's webinar as well. The sense that, you know, we just throw everything together now because, you know, separating materials may also be a dangerous activity, either at the household level, from the informal sector or formal sector providers. And it's really disrupted a lot of efforts on source separation, a lot of education on source separation, where now, you know, working with waste is seen as a potentially dangerous thing to your health. So coupled with that, we've seen supply side disruptions. Recycling centres, Paolo raised a slide there in which, you know, over 90% of recycling centres have been closed in a number of countries, and that includes developed and developing countries as well. And systems have been essentially stopped. And it doesn't matter if, you know, I was talking to the country team, our country team in Senegal overnight, and a lot of the recycling systems and centres have been closed, but also Wellington and New Zealand has stopped access to recycling centres because there's restrictions on people's movements, but also recycled materials are seen as potentially contaminated and dangerous to handle. And of course, there's transport and workforce disruptions facing the informal sector and developing countries. Their ability to pick materials from different neighbourhoods and communities and transport them to others for a vital source of livelihood, all of this has been disruptive as well. So people's livelihoods have been disrupted in terms of their transport limitations, and also their fear of contamination and the closure of many recycling stations and the purchasing that goes alongside of that. And of course, we raised this last week, and it'll be a particular theme for next week in terms of biohazard risks and the risk to waste workers, and especially the informal sector and waste pickers. Something also maybe to be discussed in future is the potential for waste picker discrimination and stigmatization. I think that that's something that we need to keep an eye on. Many waste pickers come from quite marginalized and poorer communities, and sometimes that's ethnically defined, or it's defined by religion, in the case of, say, for example, Cairo. And I think we need to keep an eye on the potential discrimination of waste pickers as seen as potential carriers of viruses because they're working with these materials as well. So there's a strong human rights dimension, which I think is important. However, I want to finish on a kind of a slightly positive note as well. And hopefully, you know, my positive message is that I'm hoping, and we're all hoping, that these are time-bound disruptions, that these are things that can be overcome, and we can move towards back to where we were, maybe even in a stronger position involved in the waste community as a result of this pandemic. So what are some of the opportunities? Yes. What are some of these opportunities for the waste structure? Well, I think some of the opportunities and some of the positive things is that there's been a really strong focus on clean and healthy public environments, particularly public spaces, and also coupled with that, the right to a healthy environment. I think that that's been a very strong driver to be able to link with waste management in future. I think, you know, there's been a great example from Accra and Ghana of a mass cleanup of the city. All of government, local government, central government, the private sector and communities have engaged. But of course, on the other hand, you know, in Senegal, for example, their public cleaning days have been shut down for the time being. But I do think overall there's a desire and an understanding that public environments should be healthy, they should be clean, and people have a right to those environments as well. And that's very strongly coupled with waste management. That's then linked to services and basic infrastructure as critical public goods. That is that, you know, a decent and effective waste management system is fundamental to a healthy environment, to a clean environment, and that this is a critical public good, not just a private good. So we're also hoping to see greater engagement with local and national governments and the private sector and partnership to focusing on waste management as being an essential part of a clean and healthy environment. And so the sustaining the mindset change and greening the recovery is a critical part of that. And I think my final points are really on these last terms. If I can talk about, for example, an innovation with regards to Korea, for example, in terms of overcoming fear of contaminated materials, those that have are found to be to have a positive response to a positive test in terms of the virus, or those that are undergoing their 14-day stand down period when they enter their country, have a completely separate waste disposal system, different bags, different pickup system, and so on. So there's lots of innovations around waste management, which potentially I think are very, very useful to learn from. And I think the final lesson has been that, you know, that we have shared vulnerabilities and also potentially shared benefits from clean and healthy environments, from an effective waste management system, and that we cannot afford to see in future different parts of our urban environment being affected negatively and think that somehow we can be divorced from the implications and impacts of that. And then if I can borrow from, of course, the SDGs in terms of, you know, one of the things that we've also learned is that we can't leave anyone's health behind. As we're in a global community, a pandemic that started in a medium to large sized city in China, as someone's it's become everybody's business, and it's affected everybody's lives, everyone's livelihoods. And we must now confront the fact that, you know, we can't have unhealthy environments in one part of our city or one part of our world and not be affected that by that as a global community. So I think that this sense of inclusion with regards to service provision and cloud and engaging in the solutions towards healthy environments is also a critical part of the discussion which we need to take forward. Thanks very much, Nell.
Great. Thank you, Donovan. I just have a quick follow-up question. Please keep it short so the others also have time. Sure. You mentioned about the new and old the rise of new and old waste. Do you think we will see a surge in marine litter?
Yes, I think that's one of the concerns, particularly with the kinds of new waste we're seeing. They're very small plastic forms, obviously gloves and masks and smaller plastic bags and so on. So I think these things can very easily, they're not bulky products, so they very easily find their ways into ecosystems, into river systems, into public areas. And then, of course, as we know from the connection with contaminated and plastic polluted river systems into our oceans. So the concern is that these are relatively valueless materials in terms of masks and in terms of very thin gloves. They're not recyclable. They don't have a recyclable value. And when things don't have this value, they're not collected, they're not picked, and they find their way into our ecosystem. So I think it's extremely important that we find solutions to this, these new forms of waste as quickly as possible.
Great, thank you. We will come back with more questions to you later.
Thank you, pleasure.
Before the next panelist, and before we go over to experiences from municipalities, we have another poll for you. Today is poll time. So please look at your screen, get ready to process. This was a question we already asked last week, and that's why we wanted to do it again this week. Question is, has your personal waste generation increased since the start of COVID-19? It's a simple yes, no, not sure. So everyone should be able to vote. I'll just give you a couple of more seconds. And then we will share the results with you. So after, I mean, we can always see what happens. So now in the end, it's like 50-50 more. It's 50% say yes, it increased, 50% more or less no. Only a few people are not sure. So this is actually last week we had that more people said yes, but it was also more or less 50-50. So I guess that's just the result of it. Our next speaker is Nicola Herrmann, who is working for the Municipal Department 48 in Vienna, which is in charge for municipal soil waste management in Vienna. She first worked in the field of waste minimization, managing several waste prevention projects of the city of Vienna. Since June 2018, Nicola works in foreign relations and is mainly in charge for technical communication of the Viennese waste management model to both other specialists from the field or the public. She studied bioresource management in Vienna and Georgia, USA, and later on specialized on waste management. Dear Nicola, we are happy that you're here and looking forward to hear from Vienna.
Hello. Hello, everyone. I'm just sharing my screen with you so you can see my presentation as well. All right, so you can see the presentation correctly?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Okay, perfect. So I can start. Yes, hello, everybody. My name is Nicola Herrmann. Thanks for the introduction, Nela. I work for the Municipal Department 48 in the city of Vienna, which is responsible for waste management and others. So since the listeners are very global, I decided to start with a short introduction of the city. Vienna has almost 2 million inhabitants on an area of 415 square kilometers. And we have almost 1,900,000 households, which is the entity MR48 works with, since we're responsible for the municipal waste collection. And Vienna is also the capital city of Austria, but at the same time, its own province, which is important because it means that we have our own waste management law, since in Austria, every province has their own waste management law. Okay. All right. So who is responsible for municipal waste management in Vienna? Like for every public service, the head of responsibility is the mayor of our city, which currently is Michael Ludwig. You can see him here in the picture. And then we have several city councillors who are responsible for more specific areas of city management then, and the city councillor who is responsible for waste management and others is Uli Sima, the woman next to our mayor here. As an authority, another municipal department is in charge called MR22, the Department for Environmental Protection. So they basically make the rules. And on an operative level, it's the department I work for, MR48, together with Wien Energie, which is the municipal energy provider. The main task of MR48, which is important to understand when we come to how we adapted the system now to the COVID-19 situation, we are not only in charge for waste management, but we are also in charge for many other things like street sweeping or winter service or running the recycling centers of the city or the whole vehicle fleet and more. So in this situation, we had the possibility to look onto a very big pool of employees and manpower who also work in less pressing fields than waste collection services, which helped us a lot. But I will get to that a little bit later. So just that you have a brief idea of the municipality, we have 3,200 employees in total, and almost 90% of them are really operative and on the streets. And we have 720 waste collectors using 290 collection trucks, usually from Monday to Friday, sometimes also on Saturdays. And another pool of almost 1,000 workers who work in street cleaning services. Our model in Vienna is that we as a municipality are in charge for the entire chain of waste management. We do not have contract with private treatment facilities like in a lot of other places, but it's actually all organized on the municipal level. So from planning, collection, over treatment until the disposal of the residuals from incineration, everything is basically in the public hand. We have a system of soil separation in Vienna. So the people, the citizens, are responsible for putting their waste into the right bin. Everything that ends up in the residual waste in Vienna is being incinerated without any sorting. So the residual waste is picked up and brought directly to one of the waste to energy plants. And the rest of the bins, which are paper and carton, now we have a mixed bin for beverage cartons, metal scraps and plastic bottles, and also an organic waste fraction for garden waste, same as glass, see-through glass and colored glass. Those materials are then further sorted and brought to recycling. We have roughly the same numbers of bins for residual waste as we do have for recyclables. And now during COVID-19, our main focus was really to keep the collection services at the same quality as they were before. And all residual waste and recyclables were collected as usual. So the soil separation was still the same as it was before the crisis. What has changed, as speakers before me have already mentioned, were the separate collection centers where waste streams that are not as frequent are collected, like bulky waste or hazardous waste from households and others. And those collection centers were closed for almost a month. So they were completely closed except 4 out of the 16 for only firms, but completely closed for the households from March 17 to April 14th. And on April 14th, after the Easter weekend, we were able to open up 9 out of our 16 recycling centers again, also to the public and with special measurements like in many other places. So we also have a limited amount of cars that are allowed to go into the recycling centers, and people have to wear masks and remain distant. All good?
Yes, please continue. I think there was some background noise.
We have 4 waste incineration plants operating in the city of Vienna. They are used for municipal waste from households, but also for waste that in composition is considered household waste, but actually origins from small companies or public services or alike. And the contaminated waste, because of the virus now, was also collected with that residual waste. Since all of it is burned at over 800 degrees, the virus is killed during this process, and we could basically continue business as usual, as we also before didn't landfill any waste, and so no danger came from that special waste stream. We also have a composting plant that is also operated by the city of Vienna with a capacity of about 100,000 tons. In Vienna, we are very strict about the separate collection of organic material, and we already before the crisis only collected green waste and garden waste, so no kitchen waste from households that goes into the residual waste. And therefore, we were also able to continue the collection of the organic bins as usual and to compost the material, because from that green and garden waste, also no danger has to be feared there. We have 1 landfill operated by the city, which is in the 22nd district inside the city boundaries. But this landfill is only used for residuals after the waste incineration. So slags and ashes are mixed with concrete and then brought to this landfill. And again, there are no health risks emerging from it. So we basically could maintain it as before the virus. We stocked up a little bit on private truck companies who helped us bringing the residuals from the waste incineration to the landfill. That was the only measurement we took there because our trucks were mainly all used in actual waste collection from households during the time. One more thing that the city runs is the reuse shop. We do have a lot of waste prevention programs in the city of Vienna, and this is one of the biggest ones. So the materials for the reuse shop is usually collected at the recycling centers, which then wasn't, since they were closed for a month, no material was collected, which didn't cause any problem as the shop obviously was closed as well. We are planning to reopen the shop in the first week of May. And since the collection centers have been open already for 2 weeks, basically all the background of this has been in place already. Now, which measurements have we actually taken because of COVID-19? So as I already said, our main focus was really on maintaining the collection services at the same quality as before. The collection trucks are usually starting at 6 in the morning in the city of Vienna, and we changed that into 3 different shifts so we could reduce contacts between our employees at the contact rooms, at the common rooms in the morning. So we had a third of them starting at 6 as usual, and then another shift at 6:30 and at 7. The separate collection and recycling was also maintained as usual, as I already mentioned. All waste treatment plants remained running on full capacity. Our employees were, of course, instructed to do some changes in their everyday behavior, like wearing the masks and wash their hands when possible, when returning back to the common rooms and so on, or use hand disinfectant gel while on the collection trucks. We were able to produce enough hand disinfectant gel in our own laboratory, which was close to all other activities. And street sweeping services have been reduced greatly by almost 90%. The pool of workers who is usually used in street sweeping was a backup pool for the collection services. So we could assure that even if a COVID-19 positive case occurs, and then all the employees who were in contact with this person can be directly replaced by our at-home pool. As I said, the recycling centers were closed for citizens for almost a month. The reuse shop is closed, but will reopen in the beginning of May, and the office staff was changed to home office as far as possible. For office staff that still had to go back into the office, we basically had made a plan so that those people are always just in their office by themselves and there's no contact between the employees. Then coming to the communication with the citizens. So in general, MR48 has a call center that is operating every day from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. The phone number of our call center is printed on every waste bin throughout the city of Vienna. And this was a very important communication tool also during this time. So everything was operating at the normal hours and the phones were ringing a lot. But we were able to keep the communication up just fine. Also, we had some written information, of course. We continuously updated our homepage with the new measurements, for example, concerning the recycling centers. And we also used social media channels like Facebook and Instagram a lot during the crisis. So everything that was new, like the closing or the opening of recycling centers, or also measurements like how to get rid of your household waste now was communicated over all of those channels. And what we also know from all of our communication channels is that the feedback was very, very positive. We got a lot of drawings from children to encourage our workers, and people were also clapping when the waste collectors came. So overall, we got the feedback that the people are happy with our services during the crisis, and also appreciate that everything was maintained as it was. So thank you for your attention, and I'm open for questions.
Great. Thank you, Nicola, for this very nice presentation about the Viennese model and about how you communicated with the citizens. And it's great to hear that you also get positive feedback. It's always good to have like positive loop at the same time. Just a quick follow-up question from the audience. And the question is, you referred to street cleaning as less essential. You said you like decreased it to almost 90% or something. So the question is, for this, did you conclude that street cleaning does not affect or like does not contribute to the spreading of the pandemic or to preventing the spread of the pandemic?
So in the beginning, we reduced the street sweeping activities by a large percentage in order to have a pool of workers to maintain our main focus, which was the collection of household waste. And we also experienced a decrease in necessity for street cleaning activities, as really a lot less people were out and about on the streets. And also in the beginning, we did not have a mask policy in Vienna yet. So that problem with public contamination with masks and gloves and so on didn't appear during the first weeks. As people started to go out more again and to use the streets more again, we also stocked up this pool again. So basically the distribution of the workers was quite dynamic, and as the cases reduced and we needed less backup workers, since the risk was reduced for collection workers to drop out and people used the streets more at the same time, we were able to shift some workers as to where they are needed.
Great. Okay, thank you for sharing. We will now go to our last poll. So everyone get ready to wake up again from the audience. This one is about communication. We just heard that effective communication is like important and also can be effective, as people are saying that they knew very well what happened. So please let us know how your city communicated with you, yourself. Did you always know what was happening, what you had to do? You heard about some changes but had to look them up, or were you not at all informed about changes? The last one is of course also valid if there were no changes, because we heard earlier there were some cities where no changes were done to the waste management collection or the waste collection. Okay, I will give you a few more seconds and then we are closing the poll. So a lot of people are saying they were not informed about changes. It could also be because there were no changes. But at least a fifth is saying, yes, they always knew what to do. And so maybe there can be some more improvement about communication. We will come back maybe with some questions to Nicola afterwards. Now, our last presenter for today is Zhang Cheng, who is currently responsible for municipal waste classified collection in Wuhan, China. She has been engaged in garbage classification for 2 years and has experience in the theory and practice of garbage classification. She is familiar with the garbage classification process and has participated in the assessment in evaluation of garbage classification. She graduated from Wuhan University with her master's degree. So please, Cheng, you can start talking and sharing with us what Wuhan did.
共享是吗?
Okay, there seems to be still some technical.
Okay.
Please, you can go ahead with your presentation. We can see and hear you.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Thanks for inviting Wuhan to participate in this meeting. I'm going to introduce the work of municipal solid waste management in Wuhan during the epidemic of COVID-19. Wuhan is the largest city in the central China with a land area of 8,569 square kilometers and permanent population of more than 11 million. The municipal solid waste gathering at collection points are containers from households and then sent to transport stations by environmental sanitation works. It is further transported to nearby disposal sites by larger vehicles. There are 9 disposal sites, which are 2 landfill sites, 5 incineration plants, and 2 pre-treatment plants. In 2019, the daily average collection and disposal municipal solid waste 12,000 tons. The outbreak of COVID-19 epidemic has brought great challenges to the municipal solid waste management in Wuhan. As an important part of city functioning operation, how to manage the municipal solid waste quickly, safely, and effectively is the duty and mission of every environmental sanitation work. We face the different challenges at different stages of the epidemic. In the early stage, we face the challenge of how to deal with the solid waste discharged by some patients isolated at home. And later we face the deal with the solid waste from designated hospitals, cabin hospitals, as well as designated central isolation places and temporary shelter hospitals. How to dispose of discarded face masks? These are all the problems we need to solve. Based on the new situation, Wuhan City adjusted the municipal solid waste collection, transportation, and disposal mode to ensure the safety of the whole process. 1. Improve the collection, transportation, and disposal mode of municipal solid waste during the epidemic of COVID-19. The quantity of daily municipal solid waste collection decreased from 12,000 tons to 6,800 tons due to the community lockdown, personnel mobility control, enterprise and shops, restaurants shutdown, etc. It was significantly lower than usual. In order to avoid the risk of secondary pollution caused by waste disposal, we have made 2 adjustments. First, closed the municipal solid waste landfill sites on February 6th this year. All municipal solid waste sterilization to the environmental sanitation facilities, such as waste collection containers, transport vehicles, transfer stations, disposal plants every day, strictly follow the technical standards to ensure the safety of whole collection, transportation, and disposal process. Up to now, we have collected and disposed the municipal solid waste more than 500,000 tons this year. We achieved the daily cleaning and ensured the clean and orderly city appearance and environment. 2, implement the mode of classified collection, transportation, and disposal of epidemic-related wastes. as a solid waste from hospitals, temporary cabin hospitals, isolation observation points and other epidemic sites, and the waste masks in public areas are defined as epidemic solid waste, which was disposed following the rules of medical waste. During the epidemic period, more than 5,200 tons of epidemic-related solid waste were collected, transported, and disposed in Wuhan, with an average daily output of about 90 tons. To avoid epidemic-related solid waste becoming a new source of virus transmission, we have formulated special technical specifications to ensure its safe and effective disposal. On the one hand, we have implemented classified discard and collection. We have set up special collection containers for epidemic-related solid waste inside and outside the epidemic-related places, and set up special collection containers for wasted masks in dense public areas. And people are guided to put epidemic-related waste in special containers through extensive publicity. Meanwhile, environmental sanitation works are required to give priority to cleaning epidemic-related waste during patrol cleaning. On the other hand, classified transportation and disposal are carried out. Designed personnel and vehicles collected the epidemic-related waste by schedule. The works were trained professionally and the vehicles were registered at incineration plants. The wastes are incinerated as soon as possible after entering the plants. It is stipulated that the incineration plants do not receive the epidemic-related solid waste by unregistered vehicles at non-scheduled time. There shall be no leakage during transportation and unloading. 3. Strengthen the protection measures for environmental sanitation works. In order to effectively reduce the risk of environmental sanitation works infected with the virus in their work, we have mainly taken the following measures. First, provide frontline works enough protection of materials which were from government procurement, allocation, donations. These materials include masks, gloves, goggles, protective clothing, disinfectant, and other necessary protective materials to ensure the protection of works. The second is to strengthen the professional training before taking the duty, supervision and inspection of personnel during work, urging workers to wear protective equipment according to the standard operation procedures, and regularly disinfect the operating tools and equipment, such as brooms, garbage pickup players, small cleaning vehicles, etc. Third, for those high-risk works, the principle is all stay in one place and individual isolation. The accommodation and dining are arranged in a unified way. Take body temperatures every day. After one operation cycle, isolation shall be conducted uniformly to ensure no cross-infection. Fourth, we started and issued incentive policies. We provide temporary subsidies for epidemic prevention and control work to qualified works so as to improve their enthusiasm, team stability. At present, COVID-19 epidemic has been effectively controlled in Wuhan, and all the work of city resumption and rehabilitation has been accelerated. The operation of urban function has gradually entered the right track. And the disposal of municipal solid waste has also been transferred to normal. I hope that some of our experiences and practices can provide you with some reference and help. Thank you. Thank you all.
Great. Thank you so much, Peng, for sharing this. And for the audience to know, my colleague, Shenzhen, excuse me, Shang, from our UN Habitat office in China, will help translating some of our questions. The first question would be, what lessons have you learned? Which advice would you give our listeners, especially officials from municipalities?
Hello.
Sorry. Can you repeat the question again? Sorry.
Sorry, yes. Which lessons have you learned and which advice will you give to our listeners, especially officials from municipalities?
Okay.
Please
wait a minute.
我们作为这个生活垃圾这个死板部门，我们要想这个垃圾的产生的量在哪里？ 然后有一些涉疫的垃圾我们该怎么处理？因为涉疫的垃圾它可能会存在这个次生的这个污染问题。那么我们就第一个要想到它的这个垃圾量产生在哪里，哪些是涉疫垃圾，怎么做规范的处理，避免这个次生环境次生污染的问题。
OK， 你承认您回答吧。 OK。 The answer to the question is that mainly is told the quantity of solid waste and where those solid waste has the relation with this related to this epidemic, so that you can collect those solid waste separately so that reduce the
can you repeat that last part? Unfortunately, we lost your connection, Shenzhen.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Shenzhen, unfortunately, we cannot hear you at the moment. So please hold on to that answer. And we will come back to you in a second. Maybe the connection is going to be better. Okay, so we will now go over to our general questions and answers session. I will ask all the panelists to come and to come online again to show us their cameras. And then we will take some questions. And I will start with Paolo, as you were the first. The first question is there any research done on the contribution of waste management to the spreading of COVID-19?
Yeah, thank you for the question. Actually, currently there are no evidence on a scientific point of view that there are some spreading of the virus through the waste. But since there are no evidence about the spreading, there are no evidence about the other way around. So it's important to keep the focus on safety measures. And let's say that there are, we have seen that in different countries they are taking precautions to limit the potential infectious load in the waste. So maybe asking people to store for a while their waste before put the waste out for collection, or also storing the waste before sorting and treatment processes in recycling centers, because in many recycling centers there are a lot of manual operations. So I think that we cannot still say that there are evidences about the spreading, but it's true that in order to make sure that the workers are safe and they can work in a let's say quiet and business as usual way, we need to provide them with accurate information about the safety measures. And so some of these precautions, like storing for a while the waste, can be in a way going to the direction to reduce the potential infectious load, even if fortunately so far we don't have any specific evidences about it.
Okay, great. Thank you. At this point, I want to encourage the audience to send all the questions they have. We will, of course, not be able to answer all of them, but we will ask the presenters to answer them afterwards, and we will let them know the answers that we know to you.
Sure.
So, Donovan, what, according to you, are contaminated waste streams and which are not?
Well, that's the difficult thing to know. I mean, what we see is a sense. I think there's two different things. There's the science and the perception, which are driving things. So, you know, as that fantastic presentation from Wuhan pointed out, the focus then was on that direct medical waste, the waste that had come into direct contact with known people infected with COVID-19. So in their case, the waste that was seen as the most contaminated and which needed to be separated out and incinerated and transported in certain ways, with the waste workers as well being supported in certain ways, was that which had direct, have a direct relationship to those that carried the virus, and those also, of course, looking after those with the virus. What we know less of is other forms of potential waste products, plastics, cardboard, paper, tissues, and so on. And we have some guidelines from WHO on the lifespan of the virus in a form that can be transmitted on some of those materials and surfaces, but it's not completely clear with respect to the science on that. And what we see then is the perception driving or filling that gap. And that is that Paolo mentioned the issue of, for example, of storing waste in the home. But in several cities, for example, people are being discouraged to store their recyclables at home, but to get them out as soon as possible for fear that that could contaminate people in a household. So there's a lot of, this is why I was saying earlier on, there's a lot of sort of mixed messages. And I guess in that vacuum of clear science and information, there's a sense that potentially all products at any time could become potential contaminants and potentially toxic. And in that respect, I think all waste streams are being treated in such a way which is you know, which is driven by that vacuum of information and I guess the fear of waste streams. And I think that that's something which that's a gap of information that I think waste management professionals and those that are working in the waste management system during this pandemic need to help fill for the authorities that information vacuum as quickly as possible for households and for informal sector workers and pickers and so on, so we can maintain an effective waste management system and one that protects the health of all of those in it.
Okay, thank you. Nicola, someone from the audience wanted to know if some of your waste workers were reluctant to go out and collect waste.
Excuse me, I didn't get it.
Sorry. The audience was wondering if some of your waste workers were reluctant to go out and collect waste.
No, actually, we had really good motivation throughout all of our employees during the whole time. And we even internally experienced a minimum of sick leaves during this time. So everybody was really strongly bonded together, and the team spirit, I would say, was on top.
That's great to hear. And someone else was wondering if there was, like, we heard from Wuhan that the waste generation was actually dramatic, like almost 50% decrease. Do you know anything, do you already have any data about Vienna? Was it like, did the waste generation change in the last 2 months?
They are observing that at the moment. I know that some communities in Austria have already published their numbers. I think in Upper Austria an increase was published, and also in the area of Graz. We are right now monitoring it, and as soon as we have official results, I'm happy to share them.
That would be very interesting. Thank you. I'm going to ask my colleague, Sen Chan, is Cheng ready to answer some of the questions? We were asked, wondering if she could answer them. Maybe you can try to see if you can answer the question from earlier.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Hello. Yeah, we can hear you, but it's unfortunately very intermittent. Like, you're coming and going. Okay, Sen Chan, unfortunately, we cannot hear you, so I would suggest we will take all the questions and send them to Wuhan and just spread the questions afterwards. I'm very sorry for the audience, but I guess it would be very interesting, but this will give us some more time with the other panelists, and we will just share the questions afterwards, okay? Great. Then let's see which other questions we have. A very interesting question maybe for all of you. What is your suggestions on sound waste management for developing countries like India, where population density is extremely high, also in slums and unorganized colonies, and often no collection systems are there? Please, who wants? Maybe Donovan, you want to go? Give it a try.
Okay. Well, of course, there are waste management systems everywhere. They range from, you know, the highly informal and sporadic, right, to the formalized system. So I think one of the challenges here is to identify those workers that are involved in collection, often of different materials, whether it be organic waste or whether it be plastics or tins or even electrical waste, and to be able to support their continuation of their safe practices. It's a very difficult thing to tell people engaged in the informal sector, where they're living on a basically a daily income approach, that, you know, that you can't pick or that you can't collect recyclables and on-sell them and so on. So I think the best thing for cities is to recognize waste pickers and to recognize the informal sector as playing a critical role, and to reach out with basic and essential information to waste pickers about managing their services in the safest way possible for their health, and also to support them with respect to the use of gloves and masks and other basic materials to ensure that they can continue on in the healthiest possible way. And I think recognizing the role of the informal sector is a very important part of the overall strategy towards COVID-19 with respect to global waste systems.
Great, thank you for those insights. I will use this as an opportunity to announce next week's webinar again. We will have another webinar of this series, and next week it's going to be again at the other time, so afternoon for everyone who's in Africa and Europe, and it's going to be about worker safety, formal and informal. Paolo and Nicola, maybe one of you also wants to say something for this question.
I fully support the point of Donovan, and maybe another interesting point is the communication to citizens. So even if there are no developed, very well developed collection systems, the role of raise the awareness among citizens about the importance of their habits. Also to respect the collectors is very important. So the two sides of communication, and so towards citizens and preserve safety and health of the workers is very much important. So I think that we should to take stock of this period to increase the importance of our habits in terms of protection of environment, but also the health of the workers involved in this very crucial sector.
Great. Nicola, you have anything to add?
I also want to emphasize that I think communication is key, and especially in places like that, it's very important that the people who are actually out there and collecting and recycling or whatever the waste need to be informed on what is now safe and unsafe for them. And the second thing is that if somewhat possible, you should focus on just removing the contaminated waste from landfills as a first thing. So make sure that this is not accessible for people who are usually waste picking on landfills and so on. If there's no incineration in place, like in Wuhan, to maybe at least have a separate area or something. So I think that's a minimum measurement that should be taken.
Yeah. Okay, great. Unfortunately, our time is up. I want to thank every one of you who's online now for joining, our panelists for speaking and sharing their experiences. We will share their slides and also their questions that we were not able to ask them now, later on. And also, especially the ones for Wuhan, who unfortunately, due to the bad connectivity, were not able to answer any questions. Please join us again next week for worker safety, and have everyone a good evening, nice day, good morning, whatever, and wherever you are. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.